You have such a beautiful world, filled with an abundance of life.
I wanted a bad guy who could be scary, intimidating, but yet had this like sense of intelligence in how he talks and how he speaks. And Peter Dinklage is that already. And so when he came in, he just brought this really dark character. And when we're in his booth and trying to find the right voice, he was like, I want to make sure though that yes, he's dark, yes, he's big, yes, he's scary, but he's not dumb. He's smart and he's always one step ahead of you. And that's how he maneuvers. He really tried to embody Scourge, and he really pulled from a lot of the Scourge designs. Like, he would look at the design itself and say, okay, what are his parts? What's moving on him? So he can get a feel of how to project his voice and who is he standing over and what they're looking at.
When we heard the voice, Peter Dinklage's VO, a lot of the inflection of what he does, we then had to readjust how we would perform with him. When we do see Scourge take a hit, you can see that he's sort of enjoying the pain process a bit and that he finds strength in that rather than feelings of defeat.
Way to be incognito.
Peter Cullen, he's the voice of Optimus Prime.
You brought a human here.
Just really nice guy. Like, you want to think, all right, here goes this star. And when you walk in the room, you're like, do you know who you are? You're Peter Cullen. You know, like, you're the legendary Optimus Prime. And he does not act that way at all. You know, a very humble guy.
We must retrieve the other half before he does.
Cullen gets behind that mic. You see his eyes sort of dim and he goes deep into Optimus Prime mode. You're like, whoa, this is amazing. Like, all that is coming from this guy who's like 5'5" or something like that. And it's just like, but he speaks like a giant.
I'm going to take back Scourge's key and then take off his head.
In the Optimus design, we are very firmly in the G1. Universe. The cab over is not the Peterbilt with the long nose. You know, it's a Freightliner with a flat nose.
When you take into account the timeline, Optimus has been here ostensibly since 1987. And we have treated it as it's not going so great. He's missing Cybertron. He's questioning why he left, et cetera. And so you get to watch the maturation, really, in many ways, of a new version that you are more familiar with when you get to the Bay films. But here you get to see kind of how he got there.
B, I do not want you going to that drive-in theater anymore.
Bumblebee was in 1987. This movie's in 1994. It gave us the opportunity for a whole new array of music and fashion and the look of New York in that period.
We went to New York to do a little mini scout, and we realized that New York doesn't even look like New York in 1990s, right? So we had to also dress New York to look like New York, but in the 90s era, and that went from everything on the production side and even visual effects.
There was a great deal of investment just digging deep into what New York is now and what New York was, and every building mattered. You know, the ones that are no longer there that we needed to put back in, but also the ones that have been built over or that, you know, are new structures, you know, because there's a lot of architecture and a lot of change that's happened in the last 25 years.
You say that like it's weird.
It's super weird.
You know what's weird? Marky Mark is leaving the Funky Bunch.
Well, it was important for Steven to have real ads, like real products that fill the background. Taxi cabs and buses and posters from movies were something that was fun to, you know, find. Paramount was super cooperative with that. That was great. That does give you a good sense of when this was happening.
Some of the most beautiful shots I've ever seen in Peru, they don't even look real. You know, when people watch this movie, they're gonna be like, oh, that was for sure on green screen, and it wasn't.
I love to travel, and Anthony and I have been friends from before this, and seeing like a bunch of Brooklyn kids kind of live their dreams and travel, and that we get to do this part of it together is really cool.
Definitely shooting in the jungle is very intense. We have to deal with bugs, mosquitoes.
But you have to hike for like, I don't know, 20 minutes. There's no bathroom, mosquitoes, and not many vaccines you had to take.
The day that it was like 110 degrees, we had to like sprint, like run for our lives over and over again.
You know, people are overheating. You have to be sure that you have enough water, that you have enough like electrolytes.
I'm not going no faster than that.
Noah, Elena, get out of here.
Miss me?
Shooting in the jungle and dealing with the elements, and I never felt heat like that in my life. I for sure almost passed out on that rock and fell into that stream, 100%. You could feel a different kind of energy in Peru. There was a power there, this mystical thing that you can't explain to people unless they go. We shot in Machu Picchu, we shot in Tarapoto, you know, which is the Amazon. it felt like we were doing something special.
Dominique was a dream to work with. She came in right away and said, Pat, man, give me some stunts, man. I want to do stunts.
I'm trying to get in on more of the action, so I'll be telling some people, like, you know, hook your girl up. I really wanted to do a lot of, like, whatever stunts I could do.
But of course, yeah, she ended up doing everything, being in the harness all day.
I mean, the harness is very uncomfortable, but to be able to say I did that or to do something like that is really cool. Us, like, really running through fire, or, like, where fire was, like, right next to us on burning cars, I thought that was pretty cool.
For them to do it and show up with a smile on the face every day was amazing.